Hi, it's Teresa from Dodge Nature Center, and it's time for another Air Around Us lesson. We live here in Minnesota, and you know, sometimes the air is nice and warm, and then other times, it's pretty cold. Even when we go inside buildings, the air might be warmer or colder, depending on what the season of the year is. So that brings up a question. How does that air move? How does that air behave, depending on if it's warm or cold? That's what we're going to investigate today. So why don't you come on inside with me, and we're going to do a couple of activities to help us understand how air behaves when it's warm and when it's cold.
Air warms up differently depending on what surface it's by. We're going to demonstrate that for you right now. So here I have a little hot plate. It's sort of like a burner from your stove, but it's portable. I've got it turned on, and if I hold my hand over it, I can feel that the air is warm. Now, to see what that warm air is going to do, I've got bubbles. And I'm going to try blowing some bubbles so that they go where this warm air is. Where do you think the bubbles will go? What do you think will happen to the bubbles when they hit the hot air? Think about it. Let's try it and see what happens. Ah, can you see the bubble? And it came back down. Let's try it again and see if we can get it to go higher. Ah, all right, can you see the bubbles? Oh, look at that one. That one went almost all the way up to the ceiling, and it's a double bubble. And here it comes back. Cool. Let's try it again. Ah, oh, look at, wow, look at how high they're going. And now they're starting to drop back down. See this one? It's coming down. Ooh, it's kind of hovering. It's kind of hovering. It went back up. Look at that one. Ooh, went back up. There's one right still here. Can you see it? And now it just popped. What kept those bubbles up as long as they were? It was the warm air. Warm air that's coming up off of the hot plate. Here I have a balloon. It's a special kind of balloon because if I fill it with air, it's going to float. From what we've been learning about, what kind of air should I fill it with? Does it matter if the air is warm or not? I'm going to fill it with a hairdryer. And on the hairdryer, it says there's a low setting, a high setting, a cool setting, and a warm setting. Huh. What kind of air should I use? Should it be cool or should it be hot? Well, from everything we've been learning about today, I would think we want it to be hot. So let's try this and see what happens. I can feel the air is warm. Let's start filling up the balloon. Can you see how it already wants to go up?
Wow! It actually hit the ceiling. Now, is it going to get stuck on the light? No. It'll actually start to come back down. Why does the balloon eventually come back down? Think about that. Well, what's happening to the warm air? And here it is, back to the ground.
So when air gets warm, it rises. It wants to go up. Once it's up there, it starts to lose some of its energy, it cools off, and then it falls. Warm air rises, cool air falls. Say that with me. Warm air rises, cool air falls. When that air starts to move up and around, that creates wind. Wind is simply moving air.
So in the demonstration, we saw warm air rises, cold air sinks. We used the hot plate and the hairdryer to make the air warm up. But when we're outside, what warms up the air? Think about it. Energy from the sun travels through the air and it lands on sidewalks, it lands on the grass, it lands on the buildings. And those surfaces soak up that sunlight energy. Now, something like that sidewalk behind me, it's black. It's going to soak up a lot of the energy really, really fast and start to warm up pretty strongly. Things like the grass or water, they warm up, but it takes them a lot longer to warm up. Touching all of those surfaces is air. There's air landing on the grass. There's air touching the sidewalk in the buildings. And when those buildings and sidewalks and grass start to warm up, they warm up the air, and that's when the air starts to move. It starts to rise. Here I've got a globe, because this same thing is happening all across our planet. The sun is shining down on the planet. Sometimes it hits land, sometimes it hits water. They warm up, but they don't warm up at the same speeds. If I asked you, where on the planet is it cold all the time, where would you say? Yeah, you'd probably say at the poles, the North Pole or the South Pole. And the air there, when it gets cold, it's going to start sliding away from the pole because it's cold. It sinks. Where on the planet is it pretty much warm all the time? Well, that would be right here where we have the equator. And air there, of course, if it's getting the sun's light's energy, it's going to start to heat up and it's going to rise. It's going to move this direction. Now, it's not just a little bit of air that's moving around. There's big masses of air that are moving. And when those big masses of air meet up with each other, that's what gives us our weather. Some days, when they meet up, it might give us a sunny day like this. Sometimes it means it's going to be really windy. Sometimes it means we're going to have snow or rain. Sometimes it may mean we're going to even have severe weather. And that's where being able to understand what the air is doing is super important, so that meteorologists, weather scientists, can start to help us predict what the weather's going to be like.
Meteorologists need to be able to measure how warm or cool air is. They need to know what the temperature is of the air. What tool could they use to measure the temperature of the air? What we use to measure temperature are thermometers. Now you can see here, there's lots of different kinds of thermometers. And there's also a couple of different kinds of scales. Here in the United States, we use what's called the Fahrenheit system. That's why behind the temperature number, a lot of times, you'll see this, the little circle followed by an F. The F stands for Fahrenheit. In other parts of the world, the Celsius system is used. And that's why you'll see a little circle with a C, because that's letting you know which system is being used. Scientists will often use this kind of a number system because it's a little more precise, and they want to be sure they're getting the numbers as accurate as possible. But thermometers aren't the only tools that meteorologists need if they're going to predict the weather. One tool meteorologists use are weather balloons. Looking down on Earth from space, satellites help us collect information about big systems of weather that are moving around. Doppler radar is another way that scientists can collect information about weather. And last, there are computers. Computers allow the scientists to take all of the different information they've collected and then predict what the weather will be like tomorrow, or maybe even the next week. Now, to help you understand a little bit more about how some of these things work, check out our website where we have some other videos that might help you understand what's happening. One of the videos is about warm and cold water. And you might wonder what that has to do with air. Well, what happens when warm and cold water interact is a lot the same as what happens when cold and warm air interact. So that's one demonstration to look for. Another one to look for is how to make a teabag rocket. Why it floats up into the air is all about what's going on when you have warm and cold air. If you're really interested in what's happening with air masses, those big blobs of air, then what I'd recommend you do is go to the website you see circled at the top of the page here. And there's a great video that they have that'll help explain what air masses are and how they interact with one another.
That's all for this lesson about air around us, learning how air changes depending on if it's warmed up or cooled down. Thanks for joining us for another Dodge Distance Learning video. Bye.